Okay, welcome everybody to the webinar, Trends and Responses to Unintentional Pediatric Poisonings. Before we begin today's webinar, I'd like to acknowledge the land on which Parachute is located. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional territory of the Wendat, the Anishinaabek, the Haudenosaunee, Métis, and the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. Today, this land is still home to many Indigenous people, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. While we're meeting today on a virtual platform, we encourage all of you to take a moment to acknowledge the importance of the lands which we each call home. From coast to coast to coast, we acknowledge the ancestral and unceded territory of all the Inuit, Métis, and First Nations people that call this land home. A few quick housekeeping notes. This webinar will be recorded and a link to view the recording will be shared with you. The recording will be available on Parachute's YouTube channel and we'll let you know when that is available. We'll also have time for questions at the end of the webinar. Please use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen to ask your question or questions. If you have any troubles with technology, put that in the chat. We have people monitoring that as well. So let's get started and talk about first some upcoming events. Next week, we have another webinar. That is preventing drug-related harm among older adults. And that will take place March 21st from noon to 1 p.m. And you can register at that link. At the next slide shows, just reminds everybody that next week is also Poison Prevention Week. So we invite you to join Parachute, the Injury Prevention Center, and many other partners across Canada to participate in this national campaign. And this is focused on raising awareness about preventing unintentional poisoning. We have a lot of resources located at parachute.ca/poisonpreventionweek, including a social media guide, which makes it really easy to post on social media channels and boost the activity around this week. The Injury Prevention Center and Parachute has many other partners that are focusing on medication, specifically pain relief medications this year. So we're excited to bring you this webinar today and hopefully inspire some engagement on this topic. So we look forward to engaging with everybody on Poison Prevention Week content. This is our agenda today. We'll start by quickly setting the scene on analgesic-related poisonings. Then we'll kick off our presentations with Jacqueline Burke from the Ontario Poison Center, who will present on the OPC's perspective of unintentional and therapeutic error exposure of children under six, highlighting the data trends in pediatric analgesic poisonings. We'll then go to Lori Mosher from the Atlantic Canada Poison Center, who will provide the Poison Center perspective on how these injuries occur and key messages for parents and caregivers. Following that, we'll look at ways we can collaborate and engage with key stakeholders to share poison prevention messaging. Audrey Elliott from the Centre Anti-Poison de Quebec will share a recent initiative by CAPQ and that promotes collaboration with community pharmacists. Lastly, we'll hear from Alice Watt, last but not least, from the Institute for Safe Medication Practices Canada, and on how medication error reporting and learning can support poison prevention and action. ISMP Canada has taken to prevent future occurrences of analgesic-related poisoning. Following the presentations, we will have time for questions and discussions with our panelists. So please, again, use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. And at the end of the webinar, when you are leaving, you will be prompted to complete a short evaluation. This is really important and it will only take you a few seconds. It's very valuable and helps us guide future learning opportunities. So please take a moment at the end of the session. So before we introduce the speakers, we wanted to set the scene for analgesic-related poisonings. On this slide, you can see that in 2021, the Canadian Association of Poison Centers and Clinical Toxicologists, Health Canada, and Parachute published the Pan-Canadian Poison Centers 2020 annual report. This report presents data from all five poison centers for the year 2020 and highlights the critical role of these centers in poison prevention efforts. In 2020, Canada's five poison centers managed a total of 186,739 human exposure cases that were confirmed or potential. The next slide shows that over one third, 34.6% of exposure cases occurred in young children. That would be under 6 years of age. And the next slide shows that in 2020, the most common substance involved in exposure cases managed by poison centers across all age groups were medications for pain relief, known as analgesics. Analgesics are commonly a leading substance that poison centers receive calls about. I'm going to hand it over now to my co-host, Patty Stark from the Injury Prevention Center, to talk about the next couple of slides and introduce our speakers.
Thanks, Pam. So when we were looking at what we wanted to focus on for Poison Prevention Week in 2023, we sent a survey out to our partners who've worked with us to promote poison prevention messaging in the past, and they said, well, what does the data show us? So we went back to PADIS and collected some data. And so what we've got up on the screen here is just a snapshot of a portion of that, where children who are zero to five have been involved in an unintentional poisoning, and there's a call to PADIS. When we looked at the top 10 substances that were involved, we saw that almost 60% of those calls were related to the analgesics, so ibuprofen, acetaminophen. So that was our focus for this year. So we've focused on medication poison prevention with highlighting the ibuprofen and acetaminophen. So we've developed a lot of different resources that are available online, some activities, posters. We've even developed an information sheet using Canada's drug facts tables to try and explain what some of that information is that is on the packaging. We're happy if people download that information and use it as is, and we're also happy to talk about branding it if people would like that. So without further ado, I will introduce our first speaker, who is Jackie Burke. Just getting my slide up here, sorry. So Jackie, it joined the Ontario Poison Centre in January of 2009 as a certified specialist in poison information. She is a graduate of George Brown College and Ryerson Bachelor of Science Nursing Program. She holds emergency, oncology, and critical care certificates. Take it away, Jackie.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Patty. Everyone can see my screen. I just wanted to make sure before I start. Yep.
Looks great, Pat. Jackie.
Okay, perfect. So I get the wonderful topic of data, which is always so interesting, and everyone's always excited to hear about data. So I'll be talking about the data trends in pediatric analgesic poisonings. It's an Ontario Poison Centre perspective of unintentional exposures of children under the age of five. I want to make sure I start off with thanking my fellow poison specialists at the Ontario Poison Centre, who, without whose help of gathering this data from our phone calls and coding it, we wouldn't be able to do this at all. And Sarah Kahn, who is our epidemiologist and our biostatistician from Health Canada, who helped compile all of this information and data and is allowed me to be able to present it to you today. So as you've heard, we've got the five poison centers across Canada, and the Ontario Poison Center is one of them. We have approximately just under 40 million Canadians in the whole country. And the Ontario Poison Center, which is comprised of Manitoba, Nunavut, and Ontario covers about 16.5 million. Sorry. So when we look at that and we break that down into a bigger picture, it's approximately about 42% of Canadians is the total area which the Ontario Poison Centre covers. And when we're looking at that, we see about over 70,000 calls last year. 60% of these calls are taken called from home, and approximately 50% are children, and about 50% of our calls are adults. And that's including intentional and unintentional exposures. One of our very common calls we will see regularly will be a mother calling regarding her toddler, usually anywhere between 2.5 to 3, who has opened an infant concentrated analgesic product when she thought they, of course, were napping. And the bottle was thought to be left out of reach, and it's usually available because they've given a dose to another sibling in the home. This is really what ends up being part of where we get our top 3 exposures for children under the age of 5, and why analgesia this year has moved right back up to the number 1 spot. As you see, last year it dropped down, it was down to number 3. And this year we've gone right back up to number 1, unfortunately, with analgesia. We compiled the data looking at the last 5 years from 2018 to 2022. And looking at these numbers, as you can see, in 2018 and 2019, these were our highest call volumes with analgesia. We had a drop in 2020 and again in 2021. But unfortunately, this year, or last year, analgesia went right back up to the beginning of and the top of our list. Fortunately, though, 90% of any of our analgesia calls we get from our homes, the children are managed there. They do not need to seek further medical attention. We are able to manage these calls at home. So when we were looking at this data, we were including ibuprofen and acetaminophen. And then when we look at that and we broke it down, we were including the infant concentrated drops, the children's liquid, the children's chewables, and every and all adult formulation ibuprofen and acetaminophen product that there is when we were looking at the data that we gathered from our callers. When we pulled in that data collection, just so that you understand, because I know not everyone here who's on the call is a poison specialist, we also look at the coding to pull in the information. And when we're looking at that information, we take every call that our specialist codes as unintentional general. It may also include an environmental reason or unintentional misuse or any unintentional unknown, if we're unable to determine from our call with the parent or the caregiver why the case happened, why the call happened. What we did not include in the data was any intentional ingestions, which we really don't see with this population of children under the age of 5. And we actually didn't pull in any therapeutic dosing errors. When we're looking at our therapeutic dosing errors, we're usually looking at dosing where the parent has given the wrong dose or the doses are given too close together, whether it's the wrong medication or even if it's related to a higher concentration or a different concentration that's given. So when we looked at our data, we pulled cases where the child has gone into the medication, not taking it therapeutically, but just taking the medication for any unknown reason. So as we pulled in this data, I know this is a lot of information. We looked from January 2018, as we said, all the way to the end of last year in December. And as you can see, the chart is quite busy, and these are the average calls per a month. So as you can see, a lot of times at the beginning, we've peaked over 250 calls per month. And I think even with our lowest volumes, we're still over 100 calls per month where children unintentionally get into these products. Just to break it down a little further, I decided to try to pull it into pre and post pandemic calls, just to make it a little easier on the eye and to understand the data a little better. So when we split it up into just the pre-pandemic, so we're looking at calls from January 2018 to December 2019. As you can see, sorry, in this chart, our calls follow almost what we would look at as seasonal calls. So in the winter months and as the school year starts, you can see we start having a spike in these calls. They start going up lower in the summer, and it always seems to be a little lower in February, and it starts moving up again in March. Is it related to March breaks? Is it related just to the schools or children having siblings in school? It's hard to gauge since all these children are under the age of five. Most would be in school, not in school, but possibly daycare, but have older siblings in school. But what we did notice definitely is every summer we seem to see a dip in our calls with these unintentional exposures. And as the school year goes, it starts picking up, and we always seem to peak over the Christmas season. When we moved into our pandemic years, as you can see, we started with a little bit of a high, of course, in January, but we did peak in March of 2020, unfortunately. So would this be related to people stockpiling medications and maybe there being more access for these medications in the home? It's very hard to gauge, but what we did see is a sharp and dramatic drop in our calls with regards to unintentional analgesic exposures over the whole beginning of the pandemic through April. And then we had a very sharp drop again in within that whole year to April 2021. We did start seeing the numbers moving back up again in 2021 and then drop. And then as you can see in 2022, we started seeing the numbers increase once again, a little dip again in the summer, and then starting to move up higher in November of 2022, during that time where we were starting to see those shortages with medications for children's products. So we're querying whether or not this could be related to them having more access to infant or adult formulations that may have been in the home that the parents might have been substituting. It's always hard to gauge to see, but as you can see during the pandemic years, during that 2020 part, we see that huge drop, and that's most likely related to the rise in all the personal care products and the cleaning products that seem to take precedence with people doing almost obsessive cleaning during the pandemic. So as I said, some of our possible causes for these exposures was the COVID pandemic, where we saw excessive cleaning, so more cleaning products in the home, parents not as many people unwell at the beginning, and as we saw sometimes a spike in numbers. Seasonal flu seemed to be another issue, whether it's a cough and cold season, with children at school, and medication shortage at the end of 2022, that we started seeing another spike. But usually and overall, our biggest issue seems to be with access. It seems during all of this time, when we see these calls happening, it's because there has been an access to the medication. So really the takeaway for us at the Ontario Poison Center is the access to analgesics continues to be the greatest issue that we see with these unintentional childhood poisonings occurring. Thanks.
Thanks, Jackie. That was great. And we appreciate you doing this not feeling in top form today. So well done.
Thank you.
All right, our next speaker is Lori Moser, who is a graduate of both health education and nursing from Dalhousie University. She has been with the Atlantic Canada Poison Center, formerly IWK Regional Poison Center, for almost 22 years as a certified specialist in poison information. Lori has participated in several committees dedicated to the prevention of unintentional exposures in pediatric populations, focused on topics such as cannabis and CSA child-resistant packaging. She is also the co-chair of the Poison Prevention Communications and Outreach Working Group and is a frequent collaborator of Child Safety Link. Lori, take it away.
Thank you. Next slide, please. So basically, I'm just going to talk a little bit about the telephone call to the poison center with these cases, what the top analgesic exposures in pediatrics, why they happen, what are the risks, and how we can prevent unintentional exposures to analgesics. Okay. So first we need to know who calls the poison centers. So basically anybody can call the poison centers. It can be, sometimes it's parents and caregivers, which would include like daycare, babysitters, grandparents, family and friends call sometimes. Patients call themselves when they get a little bit older. Healthcare professionals call as well. So that could be a paramedic, a nurse, a pharmacist. So basically anyone can call. Next slide. So often, you know, this is what you don't always get from these statistics is parents tell us on the phone and the people that are calling that they've done their own research on the internet before calling. They've called a family or friend for advice. Now, from what they've been told and what they've read about, they're upset, frightened, worried, sometimes embarrassed that this happened. They feel guilty. They're often saying on the phone, I feel like such a terrible or bad parent. Or we also get transfers from 811 and sometimes they're frustrated because they've already told the whole story to the 811 nurse and now they have to tell it all again. So that can add to the frustration. And certainly during COVID, there's a lot of people working at home. I just can't imagine. I have a child with ADHD working at home, having no daycare and you know, those type of distractions are often contributing to the calls that we get. Next slide. So this is my my colleague, Marianne Carew. She's a RN, a C-SPY, and she has been with the Poison Center over 20 years as well. So just to know that poison centers, we're called specialists in poison information. Sometimes we have a C in front of it because we're a certified specialist in poison information. And we're confidential. We take the calls from home 24/7, but we do have to get a little bit of history. We have to play detective. So we need to know why it happened, what happened, a little bit about the patient or the child, what their age is, their medical history, their weight, and calculation of the amount ingested. So this is not always simple because sometimes we don't know how many pills that were in the, or how much liquid is in. So we have to do a little bit of calculation. And then we do a risk assessment. We give instructions to the parents and we make a plan. So as Jacqueline said, most of the time we can keep these unintentional exposures at home. Sometimes we'll follow up and then also a plan as to not having any more medications for the next 24 hours. Especially with acetaminophen. Next slide. So when you look at our data, and this is with a canned report, which compiles different types of acetaminophen. Acetaminophen is the number one analgesic that children are exposed to in the age group of 0 to 18, followed by ibuprofen, naproxen, and other analgesics like opioids and topicals with analgesia. So there are things that people can go to the store and they're readily available in people's home. Next slide. So risk of analgesic, there is a risk there. It's the number one cause of acute liver failure in Canada and the US. And this means not from like hepatitis or a medical reason, but from medications. And other analgesics can cause significant symptoms. So there's a lot of hospitalization. There's a lot of exposures, what is what it comes down to. And acetaminophen is often the one that we're being called about. Next slide. So why do they have exposures happen? I'm going to talk about, there's two basic reasons that child access the product or therapeutic errors. Next slide. So here's an example of child access. So we get an upset parent calling states, I'm working from home, daycare is closed, and I have a sick five-year-old. Caller just gave the older child children's Advil, left the room literally for just 1 minute. During this brief time, the caller's 18-month-old drank the rest of the children's ibuprofen. So sometimes it's stored properly, but just due to a very brief circumstance, children get into stuff. And I always say they're opportunists. So they're looking for the opportunity. You walk out of the room for 1 minute and it's going to happen. Next slide. inappropriate stories. So here's another case of 811 transferring a telephone call from the parent of a three-year-old boy who opened the caller's purse. There was a bunch of extra strength Tylenol in a Ziploc baggie. So this happens all the time. People put medications in their baggie. Child was found chewing the Tylenol and had no idea how many pills were in the baggie before he got into them. Next slide. Another call that we've been getting more as well, it's not always the children's product, is the Tylenol Easy Tabs. Hospital calling states child was brought into the emergency department after being found with an open bottle of Tylenol Easy Tabs. Bottle contained 100 tabs when new, and parent is not sure how many child could have gotten into. And the parent also did not realize that these containers were not childproof. So we'll talk about the childproof issue later, but these tablets, they do say right on the package that they're not child resistant, but they're certainly easy for children to open, and the pills are candy coated. So very appealing to young children. Next slide. So this is a snippet from our database. As Jacqueline had stated, there's a lot of different reasons why therapeutic errors or unintentional exposures happen. And we're able to capture this on our database. There's three different databases used in Canada Poison Centers, but they all capture the same information. So that's one thing that we are consistent. We can produce this data. Next slide. Next slide. Thank you. So different strengths has been a source of confusion. So here's a case, another case that we had. Caller just realized he accidentally gave a seven-year-old son the wrong dose of medication. He went to the drugstore and all they had was infant Tylenol. As you know, there's a shortage of infant and children's analgesics. Caller did not know that it was a different strength and gave his child 12 mils of the infant Tylenol. And so just to show you how using the wrong product can produce the wrong dose. So the infant Tylenol 12 mils is 960 milligrams or 25.3 milligrams per kilo, where if you use the children's Tylenol, it's only 384 milligrams, 10.1 milligrams per kilo. So that's quite a bit of difference, especially if a child's getting more than one dose. You can see how this could add up when you have a sick child for several days. Next slide. So both of these products look almost alike. The only difference is there's a little girl on one and there's a baby on the other. So they come in different strengths. Next slide. So being fair, I don't want to just pick on the acetaminophen. We have the same issue with the Advil. There's 40 milligrams per mil, 100 milligrams per 5 mil, 200 milligrams per 5 mil, 50 milligram chewable tasty tablets, and 100 milligram tablets. So you can see how this is a source of confusion when there's a shortage and parents may have to resort to a different product. Next slide. So here's a double dose example. Caller said he just gave the 15-month-old daughter acetaminophen, not knowing that his wife had already given the exact same dose 25 minutes ago. It's the third dose the child had in the past 6 hours for her COVID fever. So with acetaminophen, we're with chronic dosing or have an additional dose, we have to total up the whole dose in 20 per 24 hours, depending on how many days they have been taking it. So miscommunication between parents is very common these days. Next slide. So wrong weight. So this is the call that I had. Caller just came from home from the hospital with her two-year-old daughter who's had a high fever. The nurse accidentally put the child's weight down as 24 kilograms instead of 24 pounds. Caller was provided with an acetaminophen dosing chart. So she gave the dose based on the 24 kilograms and then thought, there's no way my two-year-old weighs 24 kilograms. It's just too much. So then she called. Fortunately, the child was only given one dose that was too much. But as you can see, 2.2 pounds equals 1 kilogram. So that can result in giving too much as well. Next slide. Look at these labels. How confusing is that? When we get calls on the telephone, parents are often having difficulty figuring out the concentration, whether it's 100 milligrams per 5 mils. the active ingredients are almost impossible to locate. We get parents saying it's not there, and we have to walk people through the label. Doses based on age and weight. Well, what do you do if the child is smaller or bigger for their age? It's pretty high level language. The printing is small, especially when you're in your 40s or above. There's English, there's French, there's information about the non-medicinal ingredients. The information on the box is clear, but it's often thrown out. So this can add to the frustration of the caller as well. Next slide. So prevention, you really have to look at why these exposures happen. And so child access has been common, therapeutic errors, and calling the poison center is a real important key message to get across to people. Next slide. So prevention of child access. I was on the CSA committee on child resistant packaging. So it seems to be a common theme. Often people think that's childproof. I've had callers as young as 1 year old or even younger open these. If they're given enough time, they can open them. Easy tab packages like the bottle of Tylenol that are not child resistant should really be not encouraged in families with young children. Purses and bags, if you have a visitor come to your house, they may have medication in their bag, especially older people. So make sure it's put away and put up high. These exposures, if you look at the data on the times of exposures, they often are like during supper time, at bedtime, whenever the caregivers are distracted. I call the little children opportunists because they, given the opportunity, if it's there, they're going to get into it. So another important step, and Child Safety Link is really good for this, is knowing the development stage of your child. So if you see your kids at the playground, see how they climb, they can put a chair to the counter, or climb on the counter, climb up. They're really good at doing that. So really, I would encourage people to lock the medicine up, not calling it candy. And if an exposure calls right away, call the poison center. You're not going to get in trouble. You're not going to have your child taken away. It's better to call us directly and not Google, because there's a lot of misinformation on the internet. And also sometimes grandparents unknowingly give the wrong information, like making the child throw up. And that's not recommended anymore. And I've been there at the poison center for 22 years. I've never told parents to induce vomiting. Next slide. So therapeutic errors can be more challenging, but encourage people to read the label and make sure that they're given the correct dose and weight, and do not exceed the maximum dose per 24 hours. Sometimes people are not aware that this can be a problem. I had a call close to 20 years ago. Child had a tonsillectomy and the parents were given it every 3.5 to 4 hours around the clock. So after several days, the child was showing signs of liver toxicity. So and the child's liver enzymes were, you know, elevated. So it's not just the getting the right dose, but it's the frequency of the dose not exceeding what's on the label. And ensure only one product is used the same medicine. So if you cough and cold medicines may have acetaminophen or ibuprofen. Nowadays, you can't get products for children under 6, but even the children over 6 could be at harm if they were using, you know, say acetaminophen plus a cough and cold medicine with acetaminophen. So measuring it correctly using the syringe or the little cup that comes with it, if the parents cannot or caregivers cannot get that, they can ask the pharmacist. They usually give that to them. And then communication. So writing it down on a piece of paper and attaching it to the bottle would be my best thing. But also with the younger generation of parents now, texting the other parent that's looking after the child, and ask for help. Ask a pharmacist, call the poison center, being open to asking for help. Next slide. So I guess the questions will be at the end. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Lori. That was great. So yes, and as Lori said, we'll take your questions in the Q&A box and we will present them at the end of the last presentation. So our next presenter is Audrey Elliott. After graduating with a bachelor's degree in pharmacy from the University of Montreal in 2007, Audrey practiced in community pharmacy for 5 years. She then returned to Montreal University in 2012 to complete a master's degree in advanced pharmacotherapy. She worked as a pharmacist at McGill's University Health Center emergency room for 2 years, where she developed her interest in clinical toxicology. An internship at the Poison Control Center of Bellevue Hospital in New York in 2015, as well as the participation in several research and clinical projects, allowed her to develop her expertise in toxicology, which she now uses in her role as pharmacist at the Quebec Poison Center, where she has worked since 2017. Audrey, please proceed.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. First of all, I want to apologize for my English. I'm from Quebec, so I hope you will understand me. So today I want to chat with you about a collaboration project we did at the Quebec Poison Center with community pharmacists. Next slide, please. So why this project took place in the, when we looked at our 2022 annual report statistic, we realized that our callers at the Quebec Poison Center, 39% of them are health professional, but from these only 4% are pharmacists. And in that category, we include community pharmacists as well as hospital pharmacists. I don't have the specific proportion for each of them, but pharmacists seems to call not that much to Poison Center. And the first question raised here was why? The second statistic we looked at were that therapeutic error are quite often the reason of call we receive, so 17% of them, and knowing that pharmacists are often involved in the management of this type of exposition, the second question raised here was, are they comfortable, especially community pharmacists, to manage this kind of exposition? And do they know that we can help as Poison Center in the management of this type of exposition as well? And the third question raised with our statistic was the intentional overdose, which is contribute for 15% of our case of exposure. But we kind of observed for the age group of 6 to 12 years old that since 2020, we had an increase in the number of intentional overdose. And since this is a very young population of patients, the third question raised was, is this patient take their medication in the over-the-counter section in the pharmacy? So the OTC medication, are they involved in this kind of exposition, intentional overdose in this population group of age? We will go further in our data to answer this question. We didn't did that yet, but this was a question, and we were wondering, is the community pharmacist aware of the OTC medication toxicological risk? Next slide, please. So what I did, I reached out to a friend of mine who is a community pharmacist involved in different community pharmacist association as well as at the Montreal University. And we discussed about my three questions I described earlier. And I realized while discussing with her that community pharmacists are not very prone to call Poison Center. And she said to me, what are the questions they're going to ask me when I call? So I realized, okay, they need to know more about what we can do for them as a Poison Center, why they should call us, what are the data collection we're going to ask them. And also she told me, can I call on my night shift? So she didn't know that it was a 24/7 service. So we realized maybe health professionals in hospital are more aware of our services than community pharmacists. And since community pharmacists are very a frontline practitioner and they know their patient trust them, they might be very involved in therapeutic error. So patient would turn to them to ask if they should go to the hospital, what's the risk, and everything. So that's why we did this project. So we decided to organize a rotation at the CAPQ for a community pharmacist resident. So Camille, which was a pharmacist resident, came last summer and she did a rotation of 3 weeks at the CAPQ. So CAPQ, it's the Quebec Poison Center. So she physically came for 1 week at the Poison Center. She actually listened to calls. She looked into our database. We extracted some charts with pharmacists being the callers. And then we set up objective for this internship. So we wanted to decrease the knowledge gap about Poison Center and toxicological assessment for community pharmacists. So we decided to do a webinar on assessment of drug intoxication in community pharmacies, as well as a data collection form adapted for community pharmacists. So this kind of collection form are available in hospital at the triage, but not for community pharmacists in Quebec. So we really wanted to develop this tool for community pharmacists to have a kind of a form that they can fill out. And when they call us at Poison Center, they are more comfortable and the call is very efficient. And finally, we register, we did two podcasts. One was on optimal management of drug overdose in community pharmacies, and the second one was about overdose and abuse of over-the-counter product, a call for vigilance. And on the other hand, for the Poison Prevention Week of 2023, we decided to distribute around like 40,000 stickers with CAPQ phone number in more than 400 pharmacies in Quebec. Familiprix was our first partner in that project. This way, we wanted to reach out to community pharmacists to remind them that we can help and to distribute to patients that may be at risk of poisoning. For example, young parents that maybe accidental exposition can happen to their child or things like that. Next slide, please. So if we go further, what we did discuss during the podcast on OTC product. So during this podcast, we wanted to increase awareness on the risk of abuse and misuse of some OTC medication, because as you know, it is easily accessible, but we wanted to make sure community pharmacists are aware of the abuse trend that are shared on social media, for example, the Benadryl challenge, the dextromethorphan as well. So we really discussed about what are the toxic effects of these substances and what are the dose effects, for example, for dextromethorphan, so they can be aware of what kind of toxicity may be that we can see with those substances. Also, we really encourage them to report any trend of abuse they may see, because this may lead to law change. For example, codeine and gravol and pseudoephedrine are now in Annex 2 in Quebec. So it's under pharmacists supervision. You cannot buy these products on the shelf. So this is a way for them to contribute to that problem. We also talked about the natural health product to promote the use of natural health product with NPN on it. We discussed the cases of melatonin toxicity that has been reported in USA. So they are also aware that natural health product may be a risk in overdose, also for children. And finally, we talked about acetaminophen toxicity, and we talk about accidental pediatric exposure, as we discussed earlier, the red-coated tablets, the prevention messages, as well as the combination of multiple products containing acetaminophen to make sure that their patient knows that some combined product contain acetaminophen, that they know where to see it on the label, and to always consult pharmacists before auto-treatment to make sure they do not overdose acetaminophen. Next slide, please. And finally, the data collection form that we adapted is here. So it's in French, as well as the podcast, since we are in Quebec. Maybe we will translate them. Everything is available on the CAPQ website. But this collection form is very something that we are happy and proud of. It's a one pager. So as you can see, there's the first sections are about the usual information about the patient and the medical past history. And the section four, it's really the toxicological risk assessment. So if they don't know what to ask the patient, but this can help them. So when the exposition happened, what substances are concern here, what are the concentration, the quantity, the administration route, as well as how the patient is going right now, what are his vital signs. And we know in community pharmacists, they can take like blood pressure, as well as blood glucose and heart rate and usual vital signs, and they can kind of complete that. And after that, and the last section, we have the intervention section. And here we have our phone number at the Quebec Poison Center to remind them that they can call us. And we kind of try to help them to manage very efficiently these kind of cases they can have. So if the patient is mentally, if the patient has a decreased mental status or unstable vital sign, you call 911. But if the patient is symptomatic but stable, call the Poison Center and we will help you with the information they collected to assess the toxicological risk for this patient and to give our advice if we should refer this patient to the hospital or if we can monitor him at home with specific monitoring and specific observation period of time. And if the patient is asymptomatic, you still have to call us because he might develop some symptoms in the near future. So the Poison Center, sorry, can help you as well if your patient is asymptomatic to assess if we can manage it at home or if we have to refer this patient to the hospital. We also explain to community pharmacists that Poison Center can announce patient to the emergency room. So the patient, when he got to the hospital, is already announced. So this is very a good collaboration to help the patient treatment in a kind of way. So this form was very the big change we have, and we will promote this tool for community pharmacists, and I'm pretty sure it will help them to be more confident when they call us and be more aware of how to manage this kind of therapeutic error as well as abuse or intentional overdose they might have they might be involved in. So that's it for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Audrey. That was really interesting. Looking forward to some good questions. And our final speaker today is Alice Watt. Alice has worked for more than 20 years in community and acute care settings. She joined the Institute for Safe Medication Practices Canada in 2007 as a medication safety specialist, and she is also actively practicing in a community hospital as a clinical pharmacist. In her role at ISMP Canada, she is involved in medication safety incident analysis and is the lead for the 5-Question Initiative. Alice, take it away.
Well, thank you very much, Patty, and hello and good afternoon and happy Pi Day to all. Maybe we can change Pi Day to Poison Information and have it related to Poison Prevention Week, which is coming up. And I'm so delighted to be here today to share with you some of the selected analgesic-related pediatric poisonings reported to ISMP Canada and some of the initiatives that we've been working on. But first, I'd like to thank Parachute Canada for hosting this great webinar and inviting us to be a part of this wonderful panel. I'd also like to take the opportunity to thank those on the front line answering our calls at the Poison Center and for those of you who are working behind the scenes in poison prevention. I have used your services personally as a frantic and worried parent when my son got into my arthritis pills, and in my work as a pharmacist in the emergency department when we have patients admitted with poisonings. I have been so grateful for the calm, professional voice that is on the end of the line. You cannot imagine how much better we feel to have your support telling us exactly what we need to do next. Thank you so much for all that you do around the clock, 7 days a week. So today we'd like to share how medication error reporting and learning can help support poison prevention and describe some of the actions ISTMP Canada has taken to help raise awareness of these incidents and some practical things that you can do to help prevent them from happening for both family and caregivers and healthcare providers. The analgesics I'm going to focus mainly on today is acetaminophen. Next slide. ISMP Canada is a national independent not-for-profit organization dedicated to advancing medication safety in all healthcare settings through the learning from data, sharing the lessons learned, and partnering with organizations to make improvements to practice. We are part of the Canadian Medication Incident Reporting and Prevention System, and we receive incidents from healthcare providers, consumers, and community pharmacists. The incidents and concerns that I am about to share have been reported by consumers and healthcare providers, and we learn from these analysis of these reports, which are shared with the Canadian practitioners and consumers to prevent the recurrence of the same error or to mitigate harm. Some of the types of pediatric analgesic concerns reported to ISMP Canada relate to three different categories, and I'm so glad Lori Mosher had already shared some of these with you. Some of these were related to compounding. Now, during the shortage last year, some pharmacies were able to compound these analgesics in liquid form to help with the shortage. And some of the concerns shared with us was that there was one incident where a tenfold compounding error of acetaminophen was given out by the pharmacy. Some concerns were the concentration of the acetaminophen compounded were different than the commercially available products. So not only was the 80 milligram per mil and the 32 milligram per mil, but some pharmacies were providing 100 milligram per mil. And this could be confusing as well. As well, some patients received volumes of liquid acetaminophen that were greater than what the usual commercially available products were, which is for the infant strength, 24 milliliters of infant Tylenol. Now, the recommendation by the Canadian Poison Centers and around November 2022 shared with pharmacies was to compound only the 80 milligram per mil strength is preferred for infants compared with the 100 milligram per mil strength, just to keep it the same as what's the commercially available amount. That makes it easier for family members if they're, using the compounded version versus the commercially version, they would use the same volume. As well, to limit the total volume of acetaminophen dispensed so that a typical two-year-old does not have access to a toxic amount. And for an 80 milligram per mil strength, which is the infant strength, that would be 1.92 grams in a 24 mil bottle. But, at the beginning, some volumes were bigger than that, but as the messaging got out, I think then pharmacies realized they had to use the same concentration and the same volumes. Dosing errors that were already shared were the weight-based dosing errors where pounds were used instead of kilograms, and unintentional dosing with adult products versus children's because of the children's shortage and the conversion and the calculations of those doses were sometimes difficult for family members, and also caregivers may have used, inadvertently used the type of Tylenol that can't be split. Maybe they're specially coded, and so we've seen some types of those errors. We also saw mix-ups between infant and pediatric formulations, and just confusion about how much to dose. We also saw packaging and storage related type issues, just as Lori shared, where a child had accessed infant acetaminophen and had administered it to their younger sibling. Although it's a fundamental part of pharmacy practice, compounding is a high-risk process. And so in 2017, ISMP Canada shared about a death related to pharmacy compounding error that involved a young child named Andrew who received an error, baclofen, a powerful muscle relaxant, in place of the intended drug, tryptophan, which was to help him sleep, and it was compounded at 20 times the usual dose. ISMP Canada recommends verifying the identity and the quantity of all ingredients before preparing a compound using standardized compounding formulation sheets. They're like recipe cards with the quantities of each of the ingredients already calculated. That would help prevent these type of tenfold errors that we were seeing being reported. Plus, each raw ingredient should be double-checked by a pharmacist using an identification number known as a Chemical Abstract Services Registry number before a compounded is made. It's like a DIN number, but for powders and chemicals used in compounding. Also, limiting the quantities of volumes of liquid compounded for children and providing it with a child-resistant lid will also help mitigate harm from inadvertent overdose. ISMP Canada also created an accredited five-part e-learning program called Keeping Pediatric Patients Safe, and this is to help community pharmacists with the fundamentals of assessing prescriptions for appropriateness, using doing pediatric calculations, and managing high-risk areas in pharmacy practice. Andrew's mother, Melissa Sheldrick, advocated and continues to advocate for mandatory reporting of medication errors by pharmacies and safer compounding practices. She works alongside us now as an integral member of our team at ISMP Canada as a patient and family advisor. Andrew's story continues to educate and inform because medication errors still happen. And I just encourage you to visit the links below, including www.melissasheldrick.ca, to learn more about this work and the advances in compounding safety that we have been working on, and to share this with friends. With regards to weight-based medication dosing errors, ISMP Canada provided recommendations both in a bulletin for healthcare providers and consumers. A practical recommendation for healthcare providers is to confirm the patient's weight and the unit of measure, i.e. kilograms, prior to preparing or dispensing a medication dosed by weight. And if necessary, have a scale at the pharmacy to weigh the patient right in the pharmacy using a metric weigh scale. And more importantly, don't guess. For consumers, we encourage parents to record and share your child's weight in kilograms, and this can help prevent over or underdosing, and expect to have your child weighed at every visit. In November of 2022, some imported products from other countries, such as Australia, were granted a temporary exemption to import into Canada for hospital use only. To make matters a little more complicated, this product had a different concentration than either of the two commercially available products in Canada of 24 milligrams per mil. And so ISMP Canada provided strategies to help reduce the risk of mix-up between these three different products. Also, ISMP Canada issued a newsletter to help consumers and patients safely use imported products from the States as they were coming in to mitigate the shortage, and encourage them to buy only what they need and talk with a pharmacist for advice on dosing. We also worked with the Canadian Pharmacists Association to develop a tool for healthcare providers to help counsel patients on how to adapt an adult acetaminophen 325 milligram round tablet for children. But thankfully, the shortage ended, and so hopefully now families can access the acetaminophen products that are right for their children and not have to adapt these pills anymore. In the next slide, Lori did talk about a child-resistant safety closures are not child-proof, and you know, we received these type of concerns as well. And some infant products, and I'm not sure now, but in the past, they used to have a dropper to measure the amount for infants, and that dropper was not childproof. So you could use that dropper and put it on, but then it wouldn't have the child resistant safety closure on it. And so we were thinking that might be how some of the kids have gotten into it. And sometimes the lid is not always securely put back on the infant or the children's Tylenol, and that could make it easy. But when we had posted this on social media, someone had said, oh yeah, my child got into it. And when I asked them, how did they get into it? They told me, oh mom, the instructions are right on the top of the lid. So kids are smart, they can read, and so they can get into these. So if the best advice is to keep these medications locked and out of reach and out of sight of children. And just for myself, after the incident with my child, I keep a tackle box with a secure lock on it. And I always keep my medicines there now. Even now my child is 12, but I still keep it there. So on the next slide, I'd just like to give a quick update on N-acetylcysteine. In July 2022, ICMP Canada issued an alert about overinfusion errors leading to fatal overdoses of N-acetylcysteine. Now, this drug is the medication that is used as an antidote to acetaminophen to treat acetaminophen poisoning. And so this was relevant because with the acetamin overdose errors, we've heard about this also resulted in an increased need for acetylcysteine. These two incidents relate to pediatric cases, and we have since received additional cases and are in the process of finalizing a follow-up bulletin with specific recommendations after completing a multi-incident analysis. In addition, many organizations were challenged with the shortage of acetylcysteine late last year, and had to use oral methods or other conservation methods when supply was low, or scrambling to borrow supply from other hospitals in the area. Also, representation from poison centers, health authorities, hospitals, and other organizations are going to collaborate in this process to help design strategies for reducing the risk of these types of errors. So I look forward to sharing that hopefully the next time. So just to close up, messages for healthcare providers. Before a compounded product is prepared, please use each ingredient, and measured amount should be verified through an independent double check and using a CAS number to identify the right ingredients. Check the weight of the patient and double check the units, whether it's kilograms or pounds, and then calculate it based on when calculating weight-based dosages, especially for children. And embed the safe storage and disposal messages right into your counseling every time you sell Tylenol or ibuprofen or acetaminophen or ibuprofen, and also anytime you give away opioids as well. And we have an example of a sheet for managing pain after wisdom teeth removal, because many youth are, you know, getting these teeth out, and sometimes they're given opioids. And so it's really important that they know to try acetaminophen or ibuprofen first. And if that doesn't work, use opioids for the shortest period of time and for the lowest dose possible. And also to return the unused amounts of opioids they have left over back to the pharmacy for safe disposal. That is so important, not to have these leftover pills hanging around the house, even for adults or for children. And lastly, what can parents and caregivers do? Buy only the quantities you need, communicate your child's most recent weight in kilograms, dispose of unused and expired medicines back to the pharmacy, keep the analgesics and medications high and locked and out of reach and out of sight of children and pets, and talk with your pharmacist if you have any questions about the product you need and how much or how often to use it. And just a shout out to the pharmacists out there for Pharmacy Appreciation Month. We really do rely on pharmacists for their advice all the time. And so I just really do appreciate you for what you do. And so as you can see, every report makes a difference. It's important to learn from them and sharing learning through our newsletters and bulletins. We work with industry, organizations, Health Canada, regulators, and other stakeholders to be able to find system based solutions to problems that have been brought to our attention. On the left, you'll see MedError.ca. That's a platform for consumers to share medication errors. And on the right, you will see the IPR reporting link, which is for individual practitioner reporting. Every report that comes into us gets analyzed and the reporter is contacted if they wish. Many of these reports have led to significant changes in packaging and labeling, prescribing, and pharmacy practice. So thank you so much for this opportunity to share today. And if you'd like to stay connected, please do follow us on our social media or sign up for our newsletter and bulletins. And feel free to put some questions into the chat or email me. And I'd just like to say thank you and pass it back to Patty.
Thanks very much, Alice, and all of our presenters today. And so, Pam, do we have some questions?
We do. We have some questions. So I will start with this one. I think maybe, Lori, this is maybe directed to you. Can you comment on product format and the association with ingestions? For example, bright colored tablets versus easy tab versus sugar-coated sugar-coated tab versus liquid, et cetera?
Well, anything that has a candy coating or is chewable, like some of the chewable Advil ibuprofen, is going to be more likely they're going to ingest more. I would think I would have to, as far as statistics, I'd have to pass that on to one of the epidemiologists, but just from being on the phone, If it was a regular aspirin and say, and the child chewed it, they're not going to like the taste of it. Often they will spit it out, but the candy coating of the pills, and the liquid formulations that are flavored like bubble gum and cherry. Yeah, absolutely. The kids love that. Just like gummies, melatonin gummies and vitamins. They'll sit there and pour them into a little bowl and sit in front of the TV and eat them like a snack if they have the time and, you know, not supervised access.
Right. So they look attractive and they look tasty. So the less that we can make them attractive, the better.
And, you know, sometimes it's like bubblegum flavored medicine too. People put it in the fridge. Guess what? Guess who can open the fridge door when they're about 2 years old and they like the taste of it. So they will do that.
Great.
I just wanted to add, Pam.
Oh, go ahead, Jackie.
No worries. That fortunately for us right now, they are not making a gummy formula of analgesic products for children. That I think would be our biggest nightmare at this point. If they did that, it's bad enough with the melatonin and with the vitamins. But if we threw in a gummy formulation, I think we would really start seeing a lot of problems. Yeah. I'm not sure too if this was when they were talking about the trends. And so I'm thinking with regards to trends, what they may be also thinking about is with us and with my presentation, we did actually pull up the format to see which calls we had more of between liquid versus chewable versus regular tabs. I can tell you from being a poison specialist and looking at the calls, we definitely have more calls when it comes to children getting into the concentrated infant formula because they do not have a child-resistant lid on them. They are not made for children, therefore the assumption is a child won't get into it, but most parents have another child at home and they are opening that bottle. And then our biggest other issue is with these easy to swallow tablets that are coming out now. When we are having to send in children, it's usually because they've gotten into these easy to swallow or parents have stored regular adult formulation pills in bottles and the child has gotten into them.
So dosage and packaging are really key areas for preventing these types of poisonings.
Also making parents aware that if they have one sick child and they turn their back for 1 second and they leave that not on the table, the kid's going to get into it. So I think people are quite surprised on how fast children are. And, you know, that's a common thing. I feel bad for the parents when they call sometimes because they're so upset.
Yeah, and opportunistic, as you say.
Yes, sure.
Yeah, I think, Audrey, this might be for you, but the next question is the optimal management of drug overdose in the community pharmacy from form, sorry, I'm reading very small text here. The optimal management of drug overdose in community pharmacy form developed and supplied to the poison center by the poison center to pharmacists.
So we thank you for the question. So this form was developed by the Poison Center. It's available on our website. We didn't distribute it to pharmacists. We distributed the sticker with the phone number. Maybe that's where there's a confusion. Mm-hmm. But we promote this tool. They can go and upload this form and print some copies and use it as they want. We really promote it, but we didn't distribute it to the pharmacist. And it's kind of a tool they can use. And on our website, we try to put some tools for community pharmacists as well. So we have a lot of tools for a health professional in a hospital, webinar and things like that. But we try to increase our help for them. I don't know if I'm clear. Thank you.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Your English is excellent. Way better than my French. Thank you. The next question is about what are the statistics on opioid poisoning compared to analgesics just in general? And maybe Lori and Jackie, I'll direct that question to you both.
I think Jackie should take that one. I haven't looked at opioid, but certainly, yeah, it can be a problem as well.
So with regards to opioids and Tylenol, they mean with the analgesic forms of opioids, with the acetaminophen and the, so we do have a few, but fortunately enough, most parents do keep that locked up a little bit more when it is an opioid formulation. It's the ones that are really just all over the over-the-counter that parents don't seem to think about as much. Usually anything with the opioid in it, when we do get our calls, we're fortunate because usually they're 1 to 2. We don't usually get like a bottle with a child under 5. Those are rare calls to have. Usually when we get a large ingestion with a toddler, it is going to be the easy to swallow or that parents had had it in a baggie. And even when they are like the ones with the opioids in it, they're not usually putting like 50 in a bag. They're usually putting in the baggie 2 to 3 or 4 tablets that they're taking out with them. I don't know if that answered the question.
I think so. Yep. Alice, you're nodding too. You touched on that, the opioid and using as little as possible, trying the analgesics first. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really a really good piece of information for parents to have and to know.
Yeah, we did do top 5 medication errors causing harm in pediatrics, and opioids does come up as morphine and fentanyl were top 5 of medication errors, and sometimes that is related to overdoses or wrong doses. But in terms of unintentional poisonings, we have received some of them where little kids may find their grandparents' fentanyl patch maybe in the trash, or maybe they thought it was a sticker and they put it in their mouth. And we've seen those types of stories as well.
Mm. Right. Another question, Audrey, for you. Was there good uptake on the podcast amongst pharmacists? And how do you promote it?
So we promote it with the Montreal University. So that's their podcast called Éclaircir les zones grises. So I think it was episode 8 and 9. So they kind of have a good amount of student in pharmacy who listen to it. So that's the first step. And then we put it on our website. So every time we do a presentation to health professional, we remind people to go see, and we discuss about the different like the different things we have available. And I would say it's like we don't have any like funding for promoting that much. So it's really our website that we try to put everything we have on and to just remind people to go take a look sometimes. And as I said, Montreal University is very helpful with the podcast. It's a new way to transmit information, mm-hmm. especially with young students. So they kind of really like podcasts. So that's something we want to do again with them.
Thank you. The last question that we'll talk about, or it's a question, but also I think a comment. There's some interest in having magnets with the Poison Center phone numbers on them to hand out to parents. Are we still doing that? Is that something that you know, that your Poison Center is considering, you know, handing them out at health fairs, that type of thing?
So if I can answer, we chose this sticker for a budget point of view, and we did a small sticker, but with the number very visibly visible, and we changed our logo recently, so that was a part of it to promote the new logo and the phone number, mm-hmm. but the magnet is kind of expensive to do, so you need funding to do that, but that's a really good idea. But we went with sticker because of the budget we add, and for 4,000 sticker, I may say it costs like $2,000 to produce that number of stickers, so right. So that's why we went with this.
I have to agree with Audrey. The magnets are very expensive. We actually have a stockpile of magnets that we have finally sent out this year. I want to say we've had them probably close to 10 years. They ordered a large amount one year when they had funding, and just getting them out and storage of them was another factor for us. Fortunately, this year Shoppers Drug Mart did partner with us for Ontario, and they took almost 100,000 magnets to get out in their stores during Poison Prevention Week this year. So we're fortunate to be able to get that out there this year. Now our magnet will be depleted, and in the previous years we'd have them sent out to hospitals and health centers. So now we've depleted our magnet, I guess, our supply. And really our goal will be to be using our QR codes on posters, which I do probably think you're going to have mm-hmm. more bang for your buck, because most people all have cell phones, and most people don't, a lot of people, when they're calling, not necessarily are at home. So by you having that mm-hmm. QR code where it's directly saved into their phone, I think it'll probably be better, because a lot of people now don't even have house phones any longer.
True. Well, we are at time. That just flew by. I want to thank all of our presenters and panelists. Thanks, Patty, as my co-host for today, and all of the people who attended and submitted questions. That was great. As I said, the recording will be made available. You'll get a notice that it will be available on the Parachute YouTube channel. So thanks again, and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you.